Let's go to the NFC North. Vikes, Packers. Pack laying 3 at the time of this recording. 43.5 is the total on it. I've got it 26-21 home team. I think Jordan Love goes over 241.5 yards. Weirdly kind of a forgotten man in the early season conversations, as are the Packers with the rise of Darnold's Vikes, and the Lions are a compelling team. We've sort of forgotten about the Packers, like I say, in the early going after that loss down in Brazil to Philly. Aaron Jones, I think you know that he's a human being. He is in a locker room with other human beings who understand he would like to get a touchdown against his old mates. I say he gets it. Plus 135 is the payout there. Hench, how say you?
I'm in your garage almost identically. I like the Packers 24-17. This is a matchup of two coaching witches. These guys, I mean, LaFleur is just excellent. He's excellent. They should have won in the rain in San Francisco in the playoffs last year. He wrings the most out of his team. Obviously, nothing proves that more than winning games with Malik Willis. This guy is a genius. And all summer when I was down on the Vikings and hammering the under for wins total, you were saying, like, I don't know. Kevin O'Connell's a good coach. Like, that guy's a good coach. Like, you kept invoking O'Connell, O'Connell, O'Connell. And it's like, yeah, the personnel isn't there. And I think both these coaches prove great coaching can really coach up mediocre personnel. And we're seeing it with both of them. I think, you know, obviously with Love getting right, that they have a little bit of, and with Darnold maybe dinged a bit. You know, it's a tough matchup for the Vikings, but I'll tell you what's not going to happen is my plus 650 Lions, Packers, Bears, Vikings order of finish in the NFC North. The Vikings have already blown that up, but they do take their first L against LaFleur this week.
All right. I like it. And yeah, I think this coaching matchup is, you know, classic at my, metaphor. Yeah, it's a metaphor. Is the drawn butter and lobster. We talk about the QBs as though they're the essential ingredient in that dynamic of dipping some lobster into drawn butter. But you can take a piece of bread, let's call it Sam Darnold or Malik Willis or otherwise, and dip it into that drawn butter, and it's delicious. That's what O'Connell is. That's what as we talk about, it's the Shanny McVay of the NFL. If you get one of those two cats or any disciple of theirs, they loom to me at least as maybe more important than the signal caller. Eddie Spaghetti, how say you on this one?
I'm different than you guys. I'm taking the Vikings in the 2.5 or whatever it is at game time here. I mean, KOC, it's dumb to say this week going into week 4, but he's definitely the front runner for coach of the year. I mean, Sam Darnold is playing out of his mind. I cannot believe it. 8 touchdown passes already on the season. The addition of Aaron Jones has been huge. He's averaging 5.5 yards per carry. So definitely a revenge game for him. And then you have the best receiver in football in Justin Jefferson. Plus, I've been loving how their defense has been playing. It's been giving opposing quarterbacks fits, so to speak. And I just, what LaFleur is doing with Malik Willis, nobody had on their bingo board. I just don't know how long that could last if Malik Willis is going, because Jordan Love is still very much up in the air as of this recording. So if it is Malik Willis, I could see the Vikings kind of making his life hell for a bit, and KOC gets another win, the Vikings start 4-0.
All right. Interesting. I am rolling, obviously, as you heard with my pick there. I am under the assumption that Jordan Love is going to make the start there. I think they would have tried to run him out there last week if it wasn't a big divisional game upcoming this week. All right. Pittsburgh and the Colts. Let's head to Indy. The home team +1.5 right now. Total is 39.5. I've got the Steelers here 20-17. The difference is DeForest Buckner's down, and so is the Colts' run defense. It's an atrocity. Isaac Seumalo looks like he's trending to play for the Steelers to beef up that offensive line. And the other big factor is Tomlin against a young QB, this defense against any QB, but let alone what Tomlin's history is against a youngster like Anthony Richardson. I think that adds up to the Steelers surviving another knuckleball game. Colts under 18.5. Team points pays out at +105. I like that quite a bit going up against this edition of the Steel Curtain, which does seem legit. Hench, how say you?
Well, it's my favorite part of the pod. Every week we'll remind our listeners that only one person on this podcast didn't pick the Steelers to make the playoffs.
So be it.
It's one of the few things that I've been right on this year. So I'm going to ride it. I've been on the Steelers to make the playoffs. I've been on the Steelers every week. And all the things you just said make me lean on the Steelers this week, except for the fact that you can't win every knuckleball game. Like, there just will be a game that maybe you should have won that you don't win. And it's a weird one. And even though he's young and he's struggling, I do think Richardson, this is a game where Richardson's athleticism, he could make a play. And I think this is where, I don't think the Steelers go 4-0 against the spread. I like the Colts 17-14, and I like that under 18.5, obviously. But I think knuckleball game is exactly right. And I think this is one that where we and as somebody who said Justin Fields should have been the starter immediately, I think maybe we get reminded that he's not great.
Well, he does have, it does feel like the sword of Damocles hanging over his head. If he puts one stinker out there, Tomlin feels like he's chomping at the bit to put Russ in there. But I think there also is a case to be made. That's kind of how I'm reading it. Don't want to be a conspiracy theorist, but maybe he's floating that out there to make Russ feel better about the situation. You're our guy and everything else. And the calf is legitimately a mess. I don't think that they're lying about Russ's ability to go out there and play right now. It seems just so clear to me that Justin Fields can do things that Russell Wilson can't at this stage of his career. But either way, oh, the other thing I was going to say about Anthony Richardson, I'm not the first person to point this out, but the Colts have been to this point all about big plays. If the Steelers defense limits big plays, they should win this game. They should survive it. Spaghetti, how say you?
Well, you know where I'm going to pick. I'm taking the Steelers and I'm laying the points to the Steelers, my Steelers. Every week I say the same thing. Like, I think Pickens is about to explode. I think the running game has been fine. The defense is going to be awesome. TJ Watt's going to be in A. Rich's, ass pocket the entire game, I believe. The one thing that I needed to see, because I was pro Russell Wilson over Justin Fields because I think he's just a better passer. I needed to see the Justin Fields good passing game, and I finally just got that. This past weekend versus the Chargers, I mean, 78% completion. That's what we want to see from him. I know the numbers weren't super gaudy, you know, the upper 200s, a touchdown, a pick. But I think just like throwing the ball over 30 times is something that I needed to see to trust Justin Fields. And he did that. And when everything else in the Steelers is going right, just as I predicted, I think that's when he's going to shine. And I just think like it's another, we're probably a little too early on the Colts here. I just think this Steelers team in every facet is good. And the one thing that I was questioning was the quarterback play, and he just proved me wrong. So I am pro Justin Fields, and I think the Steelers win and cover this game.
Arthur Smith keeps this offense, so far at least, pretty versatile. You don't know what you're going to get week to week. The only thing I would ask is, come on, Artie Smith, roll out Justin Fields. That's where his skill really reveals itself. Next up, Eagles, Buccaneers. I don't know why this game always makes, when I see these two teams match, it always takes me back to 1980, Doug Williams against Ron Jaworski and all of that. It was heaven to the eyeballs if you like the aesthetics of football. Anyway, who cares? The Buccaneers, +2, that line's dropped a bit, actually. 44 is the total. I have the Eagles going in there and taking it 24-23. I do see Mike Evans, the touchdown maker, making a touchdown. +130 is the payout there. He has not gotten the end zone the last 2 weeks. It's high time he does so. So I'm going with Evans. Hench.
I like that prop quite a bit. I don't think it's going to be quite the bloodbath of the last time these two teams hooked up and the Bucs just trucked the Eagles, but the Eagles' problems persist. I mean, obviously they should have lost it against the Saints. That, you know, for those of us who were on the Saints, the Eagles are down to one receiver. There's only one guy he's going to try to throw the ball to, and it's 3rd and 16, and Dallas Goedert's wide fucking open. Like, hey, Dennis Allen, like, what? You're a defensive genius. There's one guy you have to cover. He's completely uncovered. Like, go soft zone. Do anything but let him run a rub route and just be wide open in space for a 60-yard gain. It's literally the only way you can lose the game is Dallas Goedert's not covered. Everybody else is hurt. Some of those guys are still hurt. Hurts ain't great. I mean, he's laboring. His decision-making, you know, obviously Saquon has helped quite a bit, but the Jalen Hurts regression continues. I like the Bucs by double digits, 27-17. And I will say this, you know, as we watch Sam Darnold, who, as somebody pointed out, is younger than Joe Burrow. That was interesting. And you watch Baker Mayfield and you watch Geno Smith. There's like a new brand of quarterback in the NFL, a guy who was highly rated enough coming out of college that all the experts thought he was the guy. And then because of the system and the situation, everyone decided that guy wasn't the guy. And then you get a good situation. You get Mike Evans, you get Chris Godwin, you get Justin Jefferson, you know, you get Tyler Lockett and DK Metcalf. And suddenly you're like, hey, these guys are good quarterbacks. Yeah, no shit. Nobody can be any good when they have nobody getting open and they have defenders in their lap. And, you know, as the last DJ defender in America, I have been enjoying him finally throwing to a receiver who can get open. Not only a receiver who can get open, but a receiver who can make contested catches. Like, so the Daniel Jones to Neighbors hookup has been great because, like, these quarterbacks, they just get, you know, they get the David Carr syndrome of like, hey man, you were sacked 100 times and now you suck. So I, you know, Baker, we don't even really, now we just know Baker's good. We're not even surprised anymore. And I think the team with the better quarterback wins this game. Bucks 27, Eagles 17.
Man, I've been looking at Baker Mayfield's career a little bit this week. And, you know, we really do forget how good his rookie season was. It probably is still his best season. If it wasn't, it was his third season. But last year was good, too. I think he's added up enough good seasons during his time in the NFL where I think you're right about that. Look who's back on the Danny Dimes train, though. Kevin Hench, he denounced him just last week. He's back in now. I think what you just said, Hench, is all a big, just a big windup to say that you think that with Devontae Smith and AJ Brown and the rest of them, Kenny Pickett is a future star in the NFL, right? That's what you were getting at, right. I think. Spaghetti, how say you on this one?
Well, I'm pumping the brakes on the Jalen Hurts slander. As somebody who watches a lot of Eagles games and has a team, my favorite team in that division, I don't think he's a bad quarterback. I think the team is just going through some changes here. I do have the Eagles winning this game, but the Bucs are home dogs, getting the 2, 2.5, whatever you have it at. I would take the points. I think, check, you said it was going to be a 1-point game. I agree with you. I think it's going to be a 1-point game, 24-23, 26-25 in that range here. I think I don't agree with the total either. I think it's around 43. I would actually say over. I just think the Eagles defense, their back end, not great. I think Baker will get his fair share. And I do think the Eagles will score some points. I know right now Josh Allen is probably the MVP of the NFL. But I think Saquon's putting a nice campaign together to become in the MVP conversation. Already has 5 touchdowns on the season here and is averaging 5.6 yards on the ground. Saquon's doing everything the Giants fans were hoping he would not do. And I think he does keep them in this game, even with all their injuries. So Eagles win, but Bucks cover as home dogs.
Shout out to our pals, Steve and Sam over there on 33rd Team on their show. They support the same thing that we've talked about for the last few years, which is, stop with the MVP conversation. We've played 3 weeks. It doesn't make a difference. Who cares? It's like, consider it maybe about 2:30 Eastern time on Thursday at the Masters. Who cares who leads? That guy never wins. So let's stop the conversation. Now, MVP talk, that leads me to Patrick Mahomes. He and his pals are headed out to Los Angeles to play, I think, Justin Herbert. Sounds like Herbert's making noise that he intends to play. Chargers plus 7.5 at the time of this recording. 40 is your meager total there. The Chiefs and Chargers and your total is 40? What about those old AFC West shootouts we used to talk about? I say the Chiefs get it. 23-21, though, so a victory of sorts for Harbaugh and company. First KC drive, they have been scoring. I think they've gone touchdown, field goal, or something like that. And then in the second half, they've scored 2 out of the 3 times. Anyway, Andy Reid, you know, game script and all of that coming out of the locker room. If they score points at all, it's even money, plus 100. I think that's a good bet to make. Hench, how say you?
You know, as somebody who's been underrating the Chiefs for 6 years, this game has always been the easiest game to pick, and you've picked it close, that the Chargers play the Chiefs tough. And I don't think that happens this week. I just think, you know, high ankle sprain is just not, yes, he might play, but you're not right. And you don't want to be wounded going up against the champs. And so even though this has been a kind of an easy game to pick, because you just always take the points when the Chargers and Chiefs play for quite a while, this is the week. By the way, you know, Mahomes doesn't get interested till January. And then even in January, he doesn't get interested until the fourth quarter. It's crazy how this guy goes through the motions. And then it's like, what's the score? Oh, okay. Well, then we got a score. But I think this week, you know, the Chargers had that nice, cushy two games to open the season against really weak sisters. They moved way up in class last week against the Steelers, and they're moving even further up in class. And the rude awakening, welcome to the NFL, continues. I say Chiefs 30, Chargers 13.
You really think that? I mean, maybe I'm more skeptical of my favorite team than you are, but I, you know, obviously that game gets an asterisk last week on the banks of the Three Rivers. I mean, they lose Slater, Bosa, and Herbert. I mean, that, I don't know how that game turns out if you have their three best players out on the field, or three of their five best players
is
out
Derwin
there, but no
James.
Derwin James. Well, Derwin James is suspended for this one.
So I mean, look, you know, that you want to be at capacity against the Chiefs, and they are obviously not.
Yeah, but the Falcons should have beaten them. My Falcons. Spaghetti, how say you?
Yeah, I think the fun wrinkle of this game is obviously Jim Harbaugh's first crack at this rivalry, him with the Chargers versus the Chiefs here. He's getting a taste of that. I honestly believe that if their coach was like Brandon Staley, I think Herbert, because the Chargers bye week is next week, and I think Herbert would be sitting out. I think he's literally playing because Jim Harbaugh is a guy slapping his pads, firing him up, and I'm kind of with Hench here. I think it's going to be like a 30-20, like best case scenario. I think the Chiefs blow him out. Derwin James, the lack of him being in the, you know, the defensive backfield really hurts them, and Rashee Rice is a bona fide number one stud receiver. Even their problems with the running game, they still now have him now, and I just think that they're going to keep, it's like, it is a boring thing to watch them, and all the people going crazy online, all the flags they get, it goes their way. Even Travis Kelce looking sad, doesn't matter. Like, Mahomes will find a way. They'll get it done. They'll win this game by 10 points.
Okay, all that's fine. But again, the Chargers maybe would have beaten Pittsburgh in Pittsburgh if they would have been healthy in the game. And again, the PI that was obvious to everybody besides the referee who was standing 4 feet away from it, the Falcons would have won that game. And then what would be the conversation about the Chiefs? Okay, moving on. The Las Vegas Raiders lost, and it was a bad loss last week. And then their head coach went to the podium and was like, I don't know if we can keep a lot of these guys because they're not trying, and I don't know what's going to be. And, you know, threw the season on its ear 3 weeks in and all of that. The Browns are coming to the town, and the Raiders are favored by 2. Imagine being an underdog to the Raiders a few days after their head coach takes to the podium and says all that kind of stuff. Bad, embarrassing times. The Browns are still the Browns, everybody. The total on this one is 37. I say the Raiders win it 24-20. Minshew rush yards. It's your spaghetti special of the week. Over 10.5, and it's juicy, plus 155. Hench, how say you?
This is crazy. This is the second time without knowing the over-under total, which I should glance at when you send them to me, that I've picked a final score that lands exactly on the number. I think the Raiders win 20-17. So I'm no help in the over-under betting. But, you know, this Deshaun Watson thing, you know, the Jameis Winston chants have got to be getting louder, right? I first of all, Deshaun Watson's 2020 season at 25 years old, he completes over 70% of his passes. He averages over 300 yards passing a game. He has 33 touchdowns and 7 interceptions. So the karma, the misconduct notwithstanding, There is nothing for the Browns to believe he's going to suck. This guy who did this at 25 is going to be bad. Like, yes, we're going to take a PR hit, but we're not going to have one of the five worst quarterbacks in the NFL. So 16 games in 2020, he averages over 300 yards a game. 15 games for the Browns, he's averaging 185 yards passing. And I mean, we've all seen the misfires. He's also like bigger and thicker and slower and less athletic. And so, you know, I think the Raiders win this one. I don't know if it's O'Connell or Minshew. I'm not sure that matters. Talk about a lateral move. But
with Minshew, right, Spaghetti? That was the official announcement this week.
So yeah. Minshew wasn't making any business decisions that got him in Pierce's doghouse. But I think the Raiders, who are completely schizophrenic, and who knows week to week, obviously the Ravens found out the hard way when they got Dr. Jekyll'd. I think the Raiders win, and Jameis is the starter going forward.
And I, you know what? If there would have been, I took these numbers from DraftKings, and I was looking for some Jameis props, and they were unavailable. If I could get something out there, just a little dip my toe in the waters, look out for that, because I would take it if those appear between now and game time. I think that's a fun one to play, like, you know, some rush total or something like that. I would take.
No, if it's 13-3 at halftime, Jameis is going to throw for over 100 yards in that game.
Well, and by the way, I told you that dominant defense doesn't transfer season to season, and it definitely isn't going to if Myles Garrett is banged up all season. He's got some issue with his foot. This one's for Myles, everybody. The Browns need a win real bad. Spaghetti, how say you?
Well, to get my pick out of the way here, I'll take the Raiders are home dogs here, getting 2 points. I'll take the Raiders in a very, very tight game.
No. Wait. I've got the Raiders minus two.
The Raiders are minus two? Did I look in the wrong? Oh, you're right. Sorry, LV minus two. Yeah, I'm stupid. I'm taking the Raiders at home, even giving two. I'm still going to take the Raiders in this game. And the reason why, and Hench kind of alluded to it, and I totally agree, the loser of this game, this will be my lock of the week, the losing team of this game will switch out their quarterbacks. For the Browns, if they do it mid-game, I think Jameis gives them an actual better shot to win this one. But if all things are equal, if it's Watson v. Minshew, neither team is running the ball really great. Zamir White's been a huge bust for the Raiders. And Jerome Ford, you know, you didn't expect much of him, but he's only had a little bit over 100 yards. Neither starting running back is really moving the ball on the ground. So basically, who do you think's going to win the game? The passing game, is it going to be with Deshaun Watson throwing to Judy and Amari Cooper, or is it going to be Minshew throwing to Brock Bowers and Devontae Adams? I'm probably going to side with Devontae Adams and Brock Bowers. I think Antonio Pierce saying what he did, only certain coaches, especially coaches who have played, and kind of get away with that. And I think it will fire out the team. And I think Minshew knows his job is on the line. So the Raiders will win this game. They will cover. Next week, I do think Jameis Winston, the noise Jameis Winston starting, is going to pop up. And I would not be shocked if he's starting next week.
In the newish era of pro football, teams that think they're in contention for something want teams like the Raiders to get into a deep spiral here and start dealing away guys like Devontae Adams. I'm talking to Yins. You hear me? Devontae Adams would be a real nice piece for the Pittsburgh Steelers to get. But if the Raiders win games and feel like they're in something, they're not going to deal them away. You might want to root for the Brownies here, everybody. All right, to the big one of the week, primetime on Sunday, Bills. Josh Allen is playing well, and that's all I'm going to say about it. And the Ravens playing well for stretches and then really badly for stretches too, within the same game 3 weeks over here. Ravens right now laying 2.5. The total is 46.5. It does make me think the bookmakers know something. Maybe the Bills have had it a little bit too easy for the last, say, what, 10 quarters or so. I think that the Ravens at the top of the statistical charts in run defense look a little bit closer. Look at the teams they've played. I think this is, in fact, a James Cook game, plus 135 for a touchdown, over 60 rush yards, plus 130. Boy, I'm really tempted to take the birdies because, like I say, they have the Bungles next. They can't really afford to lose many games. I know it's still early in the season. Hard to turn against the way the Bills are playing, 31-27. Hench, how say you?
Well, same garage. You know, it was so funny watching the Bills, Josh Allen, MVP favorite, doing whatever he wanted. I mean, literally just doing whatever he wanted. Like, I'm going to throw to that guy because he's open. Okay, I'm going to go through my progressions. That guy's open. He was spreading it around like, hey, who hasn't scored a touchdown yet? Who's And it made me laugh because I was thinking about Stephon Diggs. And the Diggs, you know, having a lot of attitude and creating a lot of friction. And it's like, hey, man, we're kind of a two-man gig here. You know, we're it's me and you, buddy. And it's like, yeah, you're Steve Van Zandt and I'm Bruce Springsteen. Like, I'm Josh fucking Allen, and you can go be a third receiver non-factor in Houston. I will continue to score touchdowns, even if I don't know the names of the receivers. Like, nothing can stop me because I'm Josh Allen. And it reminds me, I don't know if you guys remember this, but season one of True Detective, incredible. Mm-hmm. Incredible. After that season, a lot of friction between the writer, creator, and the director, and both guys kind of taking a lot of credit for it. And in TV, which is good for me, the writer is king. So the writer's like, fuck that guy. I don't want that fucking guy taking credit for my show. Get lost. You're gone, director, who's taking credit. This is my show. Season two, terrible. Well, great. Way to prove that it was the director. So Stephon Diggs, with all his grousing, it's like, yeah, good luck, Josh Allen. Let's see you move the ball without me. Okay, well, this game's going to be over at halftime because I do whatever I want. My shit's awesome. How's your shit? Well, you know, I'm not as good as Nico Collins or Tank Dell. So I'm kind of down here on the depth chart. Like, it's like you ran yourself out of town, and Josh Allen's not missing a beat. Well done. Anyway, I like the Bills 28-27 over the, you warned me. I got to say, you said Mike McDonald's not there. You were worried about that offensive line all summer. You were worried about it. And has there ever been, as you know, they won the game, but man, they're the best 45-minute team in football. But John Harbaugh's got to get his shit together, because that team stops playing when the fourth quarter starts.
Imagine if they would have blown that one. Yeah, that's exactly right. Your entire point about Stephon Diggs also applies to the team in purple. This Sunday, we're reacting to brand name True Detective. Oh, we can ride that, you know, but season two, and then whatever the Jodie Foster season number was, I don't know what it was, but it's like, you're trying to ride a brand name to obscure garbage. That the Ravens are predicated on pass rush and offensive line largely, or have been for the last 20 years. And those two things are not positions of strength for them right now. Eddie Spaghetti, how say you?
This is a tough one for me. You look at the Ravens on paper and you think everything's going right for them, really, outside of like Mark Andrews not really being a factor. They're spreading the ball around with Flowers, likely even Rashad Bateman. Justice Hill's a lot of receptions too out of the backfield. Derrick Henry, we thought, oh, he's getting kind of old, he's past his prime. Not the case. Like, averaging 5 yards a carry, he already has four touchdowns, and you know, Lamar plus all those players on defense. Then you see their record and how they lost those games. You start to question them, and I think playing the Bills, playing Josh Allen, who is the front runner for some award they give out at the end of the season right now, in my opinion, and I think Hench is too, you just really can't game plan from him. And no matter if it's James Cook behind him or if he's taking the ball himself on the ground, it, like, once they get in the red zone, it's just Josh Allen time. Khalil Shakir is come onto the scene. I mean, who needs Stephon Diggs anymore, like you were saying, Sheck? So I just think the Bills getting the points here, what it's 2.5 points. Josh Allen right now was just playing out of his mind. I got to decide with this guy.
Commies are heading to the desert. These are two of the more enjoyable watches, or at least if we're just reacting to week three, that's the case. Jaden Daniels v. Kyler is fun stuff. Cardinals right now laying 3.5, total is 50. I say Kyler goes over 250 pass yards. Payout there is plus 130. That's an alternate pass yards total for him. Jaden Daniels, for his part, plus 115 running the ball into the end zone. I think we're going to see a little bit more of that as he goes on there. I think this one's a real fun game, and I'm going to give it to the Cardinals 33-26. Spaghetti, Hench, I'll see you.
This is the Cliff Kingsbury game, right? I mean, he's his two projects,
I didn't even make that connection. Yeah, right.
And the one he's working with right now. You know, I was texting you guys during that Monday night game. I was like, you know, Jaden Daniels is the best quarterback in his division. And then I was like, who's better than him in the NFC? Like, this guy, it's not, you know, obviously 21 for 23. He accounts for more touchdowns than incompletions. And, you know, and then if you watch Sunday's games, nobody could convert 4th and 6 inches. I mean, nobody could convert, you know, the Bears had an apocalyptic fourth down play. That we'll get to Raheem Morris and Zach Robinson in a second with the Falcons. But the end of that game was like, you guys don't know anything about football and you haven't been watching the game you're coaching. We'll get to that in a second. But when Jaden Daniels waved to the sideline on 4th and 4, he's like, relax. You know, he's in his third game in the NFL. He's like, 4th and 4, you know, he's at the edge of his field goal range. The way, you know, we're not going to punt. Here's how we're going to win this game. Joe Burrow's going to stay right where he is because I'm going to convert 4th and 4. And then just cool as a cucumber, stands in the pocket, delivers a strike, converts. I mean, he did it over and over again. So, I mean, nobody could be more wildly impressed because he's doing stuff that's never been done. So I think in the desert, even though I like the Cardinals this year, I think of the two Cliff Kingsbury products, I think Jaden gets it 27-24, even though Eckler is a loss. That Eckler, that's significant, but I still think they pull it out.
Well, man, I really dig Brian Robinson, you know, as their feature back. And if you're right and the Commies win that one, by Sunday night, we will be talking about, by Monday, the conversation will become about, like, can the Commies win the division? Because if you haven't noticed, the Cowboys are irrelevant right now and the Eagles are flawed, at least. Maybe that even opens the door for Eddie Spaghetti. Eddie Spaghetti, how say you on this one?
Yeah, this game, I have the Cardinals going to win the game, but I think the Washington with the 3.5 points I would take, I think they're going to cover. I think this will be like a upper 20s, like 28, 26 sort of score here. Both defenses are really bad. That's really what it comes down to. Both pass defenses are extremely bad. And I just think that both quarterbacks are able to make plays here. The Cardinals, their rush defense also not great. So the Eckler injury does kind of hurt, but I do agree, Sheck, Brian Robinson being there is fine. So I think the Commanders will attack them on the ground through the air, but I think the Cardinals could also score versus a very poor Commanders defense that made the Giants offense look competent here. And I just think basically I'm siding with the veteran Kyler a little bit over the rookie Jaden Daniels, who has looked fantastic. But I do think there's a ceiling on how great rookies can play, especially when you have a team that, you know, the defense can't stay off the field. So I just think that Cardinals eke one out, but do not cover at home.
All right, Matthew Stafford salvaged the Rams season, it felt like, with that rally against the Niners. And maybe even more, like we say, the Niners are banged up. That is not the Niners as we saw them in the Super Bowl and in that playoff run a year ago. They're headed up to Chicago. Bears -3, and that's up from 2.5. The total is 41. I'm a little surprised by this. I don't want to overreact to that one performance from Stafford, who, as a reminder, is headed to the Hall of Fame. My opinion on that has not changed. It has been consistent for the last 5 years. That's where he winds up. Rams get it, 21-19, because the Bears just ain't that good. Caleb, though, goes over 25 rush yards, and that pays out at +130. Hench, I'll see you.
Yeah, this is a matchup between a number one overall pick who was definitely the right pick, who is going to the Hall of Fame, and a number one overall pick that's still TBD. Certainly after 3 weeks, it looks like the Commies have the best quarterback in that draft. That said, obviously I got burned in multiple ways by Stafford and McVay last week. That will stand as one of the most impressive victories of the season when you're losing, when you don't have either of your stud receivers and you're down double digits against the conference champions. You know, and Juwan Jennings is doing whatever he wants. Like, I actually, you know, I don't know, when you guys watch the games, like, sometimes you tune out of a game a little bit. You're like, well, that one's kind of put to bed. And then you're like, what? Are they still in that game? Wait a minute. Moody missed a field goal. What's the score? Like, I should start watching that. And, you know, obviously Kyren Williams, as you know, Sheck, very well, won me a fantasy championship last year. You know, very nice player. That, all of that said, I'm not ready to say that the Bears made a mistake taking Kalen Williams number one overall. And I just think there's, you, no matter how smart McVay is, no matter how good Stafford is, there's only so much smoke and mirrors in the NFL. And, you know, you can't get that far down your depth chart at wide receiver and keep winning week after week. So I actually like the Bears to cover 24-20.
Well, yeah, you're right. I like Kyren Williams, but he's no stranger to Eddie Spaghetti there. He'll tout his old Irish guy. Yeah, I mean, can't say the offense runs through Kyren Williams when you have Stafford out there, but that's a nice 1-2 punch even without the top two wideouts on the in the mix for him. And I'm with you, though, that Caleb Williams should get off, because I think they're a little slight on the back end, are the Rams. So maybe we get a shootout in spite of the fact that I have this one going under the 41. Spaghetti, how say you?
I have the Rams winning, and I wouldn't even take the points. I would have the Rams on the money line. I just think, you know, the mistake of the Bears offseason with Ryan Poles, the GM, wasn't taking Caleb first overall. They should have taken him. He was rated that way, and he was, you know, the consensus top guy. The problem is, and it was very nice of him to add all those receivers and, you know, they would Odunze and Moore and Cole Kmet and whatnot, but they don't have an offensive line. And I think the whole theme of this, the show today, is talking about quarterbacks who have moved on and found themselves in good scenarios. All the link is all those teams have good coaching and they have a good offensive line. That's something that Caleb Williams does not have. They're also very one-dimensional because of the lack of a good offensive line. They cannot run the ball. DeAndre Swift is, you know, useless basically at this point. And I think, you know, reversely, while the Rams are dealing with a lot of injuries, there's still enough there. I mean, Demarcus Robinson, Tutu Atwell have done the job to fill in for Puka and Cooper Kupp, and still Kyren behind Stafford's great. And Stafford can get beat up. You know, I don't think Caleb Williams can get beat up and, you know, get right back up and make a play. Stafford has that ability. That reminds you of, like, Eli kind of had that too, like, where you can get hit a bunch and you'll still find a way to make the play. And that's why they came back and won that game that I was at. And I actually left early because of my fiance. So I saw the missed field goal, and I hit the parking lot. I thought this game was over. Was not over. Huge miss by me. But I like the Rams to win this game outright. I just think that, you know, the theme of this Bears season will be Caleb Williams does not have time. He's always scrambling because they forgot to dress the offensive line, and that's how important it is.
Pretty big game in the NFC South. The Saints, talk about QBs in new spots. Derek Carr in year two. Enola, Kirk Cousins year one. Who's in a better spot? I told you before the season, I thought it was the Falcons and Kirk. I got to ride with them now. They're laying just 1.5 against one of the surprise teams of the NFL. They showed out pretty well, at least the defense did, against the Eagles, the Saints. Now they're headed to Hotlanta. The total on this one is 42. I'm going to take the Falcons. They got to explode, relatively speaking, at some point here. Well, I guess they don't gotta, but I'm going to bet that they will. I say they do this week, 27-20, and Bijan leads the way. Over 105 combined rush and pass yards is the play there. Hench, I'll say you.
Well, this is a matchup between two teams whose coaches lost the game last week. So 3rd and 16 against the Eagles. The Saints do not cover Dallas Goedert. Like, it's like the only guy he's looking at is open by 20 yards and runs 60 yards down the field. The Falcons, you know, Zach Robinson, okay, you can't run the ball. You got two injuries to your offensive line. The entire game, every stretch zone, every run, Bijan can do nothing. He can't turn the corner. He can't get to the corner. He can't find a crease. Nobody can block anybody. Now, this puts you in a dilemma because the same guys who can't block for Bijan also can't block for Cousins. So you're in a dilemma. Unless at the end of the game, it's 3rd and 1.5, and you could buy your gimpy old quarterback some time with play action. Go play action on 3rd and 1.5. You're going to buy him a beat. Nope. We run a completely unimaginative run into the line to get it to 4th and 0.5 yards. And it's like, okay, you need to score a touchdown to win the game. Do you think you have a better chance of scoring a touchdown by getting 0.5 yards on 4th down or by going play action on 4th and 0.5 yards? Like, it's insane. So what they dial up, I mean, Raheem Morris and Zach Robinson, like, did you watch this game that you are coaching? You can't run the ball at all. They dial up the slowest sweep. Like, it was almost like a wing tee. Like, they have three guys in the backfield, and it's just lateral forever. Like, how long are these guys that haven't blocked all game supposed to be holding their blocks? Like, yes, they're going to get a ton of penetration, and Bijan's going to get tackled for a fucking loss because it's the most predictable play on a night when you can't run the ball. And it's like, I mean, I would just grab a guy's fucking headset and fire him on the spot. Like, you watch this entire football game, and on 4th and 0.5 yards, your play call is slow developing. We're going to run laterally for 15 yards and hope for there's a seam. Like, no, you go play action and throw it to Pitts in the flat or London or whatever. So that's the play caller. And obviously Raheem Morris is not going to overrule the shitty play calling that cost the Falcons that I was on the game. But
we both had the Falcons on the money line, and I was sure it was going to come through.
Oh, my God. Raheem Morris. So it's like they're actually doing it inadvertently. They're doing it exactly right, which is you have to score this touchdown to take the lead with under 10 seconds left in the game. Like, it's Patrick Mahomes. So you have to. So when you're approaching the red zone with a minute left, don't call. You call timeout? No. You don't call timeout. You don't. So Raheem Morris calls timeout. And you're like, well, that was dumb. That you don't. You might score on the next play. If you score on the next play, not really, because you're going to fucking run the ball twice because you're morons. But if you score, if somehow Bijan breaks 11 tackles because nobody can block, you're going to lose the game anyway because you've left 58 seconds on the clock and Mahomes is definitely going to drive him down and score. So he calls timeout and you're like, wow, this guy's never, I guess he doesn't watch football. I guess he doesn't watch game film. I guess he doesn't know that the Bills left Patrick Mahomes 13 seconds in the AFC Championship game, and it was too much. Like, so he calls timeout with a minute left. Then he runs a play. He goes to call timeout again, but Andy Reid's calling timeout. It's like, yeah, Andy Reid knows how to coach football. Andy Reid is correct. Andy Reid should take a timeout here. He knows he needs to be preserving. He understands that he wants time left on the clock for Patrick Mahomes. Raheem Morris, why are you trying to leave Patrick Mahomes time on the clock to win this game in the event you score? Now, if you call timeout just to fire your offensive coordinator, then I'll forgive you. Then I'll say, great, great. If you just needed to call timeout to relieve him of his play calling duties.
I'd like that, by the way. Wouldn't that be nice? Yanked. No, like, I've been like, no, leave now. Leave your headset.
Get off the sideline. Right there and go. Now walk away. Your play calling, I mean, it's like.
Take your shirt off like Antonio Brown or your pants and just walk away.
It was so bad. Anyway, so in this matchup of two coaching staffs that cost their teams wins last week, I actually think the Saints are pretty nice. I think they've got, you know, I don't think Ray McLeod and Darnell Mooney are like weapons. Like, I don't like, I watch the Falcons and it's like, if you contain Bijan, they're not going to score a lot of points. And, you know, Kirk threw some one hoppers and I just think that Saints are better. So I like the Saints 23-20 and as bad as they were at the end of the game, that they're going to win the coaching matchup because that is an apocalypse in Atlanta. That their coaching has been so bad. I mean, week one against the Steelers, like nothing. We're not going to do anything. He's going to stand in the pistol and we're not going to move the ball at all. And we're going to make no adjustments. Like I it's bizarre. As somebody who is very high on the Falcons this year, I am no longer.
Well, this is where it turns around here. This is a big game for them, but I am sticking with my Falcons here. Yes, a little tush push, this and that. A little boot action always works. I just don't know if Cousins can run it right now with the Achilles that people seem spooked by. Obviously, you can't sneak it with them. Spaghetti, how say you?
I'm with Hench here. I have the Saints winning like 26-20. I wouldn't even take the points with the Saints. I would think they're going to win outright on the money line here because, you know, their defense is really what's, you know, obviously their offense, what they did the first couple games of the year has been really impressive. But their defense only allowing one receiving touchdown this entire season so far. They're, I believe, eighth in the league in yards allowed on the ground, still sub 300 yards, which, you know, again, you look at this Falcons team and you expect Bijan to have these like Saquon type numbers. He's not really doing that. Like Tyler Algier, you know, in terms of like average, is actually more effective than Bijan has been. Bijan still hasn't even clipped 200 yards on the season on the ground. And I totally agree with what Hench is saying. Like, why is Darnell Mooney and Ray McLeod like the go-to targets when you have London, you have Pitts, and you have Bijan? They don't utilize their best players. And Kirk Cousins does not look himself. And I just think the Saints have been a real nice surprise. Derek Carr's played fantastic. Alvin Kamara has been fantastic. And they've been spreading the ball around in the passing game. I like the Saints team a lot. And I think they're going to win this game fairly easily.